Hi, everyone, and welcome to another episode of the Legends of Sport podcast. I'm your host, Andy Bernstein. Today's episode is another installment of our series of legendary photographers. I'm so thrilled to welcome the great Pete Souza to the podcast. I became a big fan of Pete's work during his time as the chief official White House photographer for both terms of Barack Obama's presidency. During that time, I reached out to Pete over social media and we became friends, even exchanging prints with each other, which is what photographers do. I have a beautiful print of the Obamas with Bruce Springsteen hanging in my house, and Pete has one of my favorite NBA images in his collection. I followed Pete's work very closely during the Obama years, always in awe of the imagery he created while documenting the president's every move. I know what it's like to work in high-pressure situations around famous people. In my case, it's athletes. In Pete's, it was the most powerful man in the world. No easy task. It was a 24/7, 365-day commitment for Pete for 8 years. Pete's books are amazing, and I highly recommend that you add them to your personal libraries. His most recent book, The West Wing and Beyond, What I Saw Inside the Presidency, is an incredibly unique look behind the curtain of the daily mechanics of the White House. He pays respect and honor to all the people who surround the president, from the Secret Service to the White House staff, and even the iconic building itself. Pete is not primarily known as a sports photographer, but he has done some pretty cool assignments that were sports related in college and as he broke into the business. And even in the White House, believe it or not. We had fun talking about President Obama's obsession with basketball, his one-on-ones with his staff, and even with the Mamba himself, Kobe Bryant. Pete described himself as apolitical when he worked for President Reagan and then President Obama. He didn't take a stand or skew his viewpoint through his work. He just did his job, as he now describes it, as a historian with a camera. But all that changed on January 20th, 2017, when the next president took office. That's when Pete felt the responsibility to speak out through his photography and learn the meaning of shade, and published a book by that title. His Instagram account became a sensation and continues to be. If you haven't followed him yet, you should, at Pete Souza. An inspiring guest for sure. I know you will all enjoy this conversation with a true legend of photography, the great Pete Souza. And as always, I'll see you on the backside. Well, I can't tell you what a pleasure it is to have the legendary, the absolute legendary Pete Souza on the Legends of Sport podcast. And I know it's a little bit of a stretch, Pete, and we're going to get into the sports thing, okay? But you and I are kindred spirits, you know, Red Sox fans, of course. And I have been counting the days until you and I can actually sit down and speak to each other, hopefully in person one of these days, yes, but at least sure. On the podcast. Yeah. So Pete, so wonderful to have you, man. I wrote this glowing introduction for you. Former chief official White House photographer for both terms of Barack Obama's presidency, White House photographer under Reagan, award-winning photojournalist, best-selling author and sought-after public speaker, member of the International Photography Hall of Fame, a social media disruptor, a patriotic American, a Red Sox fan, a Springsteen fan. I mean, what else could I say, Pete? Come on. Did I hit everything?
You pretty much did, yeah.
There you sure. go. Well, Pete, let's get into, I want to get into your career and, you know, where you started and all that, because that's what people really love to know, is like, you know, where the fire started. But let's talk about some sports connections, all right, that you and I have. Now, I know, you know, I'm a sports photographer, you're primarily news photojournalist photographer, but let's talk about the moments when teams come to the White House and what that was like for you, okay, and what it was like for the president, especially Obama, went, because being such a big sports fan, do you have any stories about that? Because I've been to the White House only 3 times with teams, but it was, each one was unique in its own way.
Yeah, I mean, you know, President Obama is primarily a basketball fan, so I think he was the most excited when, you know, the NBA teams would come after mm-hmm. winning the championship. For sure. And for me, it was when when the Boston teams came, because the Red Sox did win World Series while he was president. And so that was one of the funny moments was we were backstage with the manager, then manager John Farrell, the owner John Henry, and Larry Lucchino, I think his title was VP general manager or whatever. And he's talking to them, and I'm trying to remember the name of the room that they were in before they went out to the South Lawn for the big public ceremony. Mm-hmm. And he turns and points to me and says to these three guys, "Well, this is your biggest fan right here."
That's awesome.
And so I have a funny picture of President Obama with his arm out towards me, and the three of them looking quizzically at me, you know, which was pretty funny.
Like, who is this guy? That's pretty funny. Now, President Obama, of course, big basketball fan, like you said. Kobe used to talk about how they had those special moments together, playing, you know, a little bit of hoop in the, I guess, in the White House as a court or something. I don't know. But you have any memories of that?
The Mamba himself? In 2010, for his 50th birthday, I believe it was. It was his 49th birthday, actually. He invited a bunch of NBA players to play basketball with him before we had this barbecue at the White House. Mm-hmm. And so, like, Chris Paul was there, LeBron was there. Now, Kobe was injured at the time, so he didn't play, but he came.
Yeah.
And he sat in the stands, and there were only a few, less than 50 people watching this game with all these NBA stars, President Obama, President Obama's high school friends and former teammates.
Wow.
Yeah. And what was interesting is Kobe sat next to Bill Russell the entire time. And those two were chatting
doing what Kobe does. After, incredible. Wow. I know that that the president, it must have been an unbelievable experience for him, right? I mean, you're the president, you can just call anybody to show up at the White House, but he's got the top.
Well, I mean, the interesting thing is he's a super competitive guy, right? Mm-hmm. And think about, you know, your chance to take on LeBron or, you know, Chris Paul or whatever. But these guys got to be careful for two dual reasons. One, you know, they don't want to get injured in a pickup game, but they also don't want to cause an injury to the president of the United States.
Of course. You know? Right. And who's calling fouls? Would anybody call the fouls on the president?
Yeah. I mean, they kind of called their old fouls. Now, I'll tell you the one super competitive, now I'm gonna forget who it was, but you know, Reggie Love, who was guy and formerly of Duke, was playing as hard as anybody because he is as competitive as Barack Obama, and he didn't care about getting himself injured. So it was kind of fun to watch Reggie play.
Well, you have that great moment in your documentary. The way I see it, it's not the way I see it. It's how I see it. What was it?
The way I see it.
Yeah, I always get them messed up. So you have that great moment in your documentary, The Way I See It, where you have Reggie Love and the president really going at it. I mean, they were like not holding back. And I guess the president blocked a shot on Reggie. He came over to you and he said, what did he say?
He said he wanted to see if I had gotten the block. And so, you know, with the digital cameras, of course, you can look on the back of the camera. So I'm scrolling through and I come to the frame where, you know, he's blocking Reggie's shot. And he just said, make that a jumbo, meaning hang that on the wall, the West Wing, you know.
Just rub it into Reggie, right?
Right.
I've had that experience a few times. Back in the film days, more prominently, Karl Malone used to have this famous dunk where he used to put his hand behind his head and then dunk it, you know. And then he'd swoop around, and I'm sitting under the basket, and he'd come like right in my face as he's turning. He goes, "You get that one?" You know. Yeah. And of course, that was digital. I don't know if I got it or not.
Right.
So, of course, you know, it was obligatory that the next time I would see him, I would have a print of that.
Right.
And now I find out that he's using that that as his icon, as his sort of, you know, thing that he uses for his social media. It's great. I love it. So, Pete, you and I, you know, we kind of operate in different kind of spheres, but we have a lot of similarities, man. I mean, you work around very high powered people. You're in tense situations. You actually have to always have a sixth sense. You know, the first thing I want to talk about really is about access and trust. All right. And people ask me this, and I never really have a great answer for it. So I'm going to ask you and see what you have. What was it about you, your personality, you as a human being, that really allowed the president more than anybody, but, you know, in a trickle down effect, to really trust you, to really let you in, to allow you to be a fly on the wall, to be at the most intimate and personal and difficult and painful moments and historic moments? I mean, is there something about you yourself, Pete, you know, that made that happen? Because I tend to be very like self-deprecating about that. And I just like, well, you know, blah, blah, blah. But I really sit back. I have to really look at my personality and what that had to, I guess, add to it.
Yeah. I mean, I think one of the advantages for me was I knew him before he was president, when he was a U.S. Senator.
Right.
And I had been working for the Chicago Tribune, and we did a documentary, not film wise, but photo wise, of his first year in the Senate. Mm-hmm. And so I was in his, you know, private space a lot. And so he got this chance to know me professionally and see how I worked around him. Okay, that doesn't really answer your question, but that's a part of it. Okay.
Right. Right.
And then you that just, I mean, I think, yeah. I think it is partly my personality in that you've got to learn that you're there as an observer. You're there to visually document. You're not there to be a participant. Mm-hmm. And also you've got to be able to know when the guy might need some space, you know, and that's just the sixth sense. I mean, he talks about it. He talks about me a little bit in his memoir, that I had this knack of being able to almost be invisible in the room. You know, even when he was stressing over these major decisions, even when he was in the Situation Room during the Bin Laden raid, it's almost as if I became part of the presidency. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I don't know that you can teach. It's something that you just have to learn how to do. Mm-hmm. And I think for me, it sort of fit my personality. You know, I'm kind of a inherently shy person. I mean, if you had known me as a kid, you know, I was not an A type personality. And so I'm just kind of a low key guy. And I just kind of learned how to maneuver in those situations without interrupting what was going on. Mm-hmm. I mean, I say, you know, people like to use the term fly on the wall. I don't really think I was a fly on the wall because I was moving around a lot. but right. You know, you just learn how to do that in a way that doesn't disrupt what's taking place.
Yeah, it is a sixth sense, maybe a seventh sense. I don't know. I mean, I, you know, became very close with Phil Jackson over the years, and I always knew, like, when he came in the locker room or the training room and he gave me that look, just like that millisecond of a look, I knew that was time to go. You know, it's like, that's the look I'm going to get. I'm not going to push it any further. Was there ever a moment, Pete, where the president said, not now, or this isn't, you know, I don't want that shot, or anything like that? That has only happened actually once in my career. But for you, in your experience in the White House, did that ever happen?
Yeah, it did. It happened once.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
and rather, I mean, so I think that, but I was usually cognizant of, you know, when it was time to to step away for a second. And oftentimes, if he was going to have a one-on-one conversation where he was going to make the other person maybe feel uncomfortable, you know, in terms of what he was going to say to them, mm-hmm. you know, he didn't want that person to be embarrassed by having me there photographing. And I got that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's just an, you know, that's just common sense, right?
Yeah.
Now, if it was, and this was a, you know, usually if it was a, you know, a, you know, like a personal type conversation, not policy, you know, there were disagreements with policy all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And I would always be there while they were having those arguments, if you will.
Yeah.
But I'm talking more like a personal
thing.
And, you know, you just have to sort of feel that out.
Sure.
And there was one time where I didn't, I misjudged the situation, and he asked me to leave.
Yeah. And I'm sure it was polite. I mean, right.
Yeah.
This has happened to me once. I'll share it with you. I was with Kobe. You know, I spent 20 years with the guy. I spent his last day on April 13, 2016 was his final game. He allowed me to be with him from the beginning of his day to the end of the day. Right. So I went down to Newport Beach. I was with him 7:30 in the morning. He's in his office doing work, you know, on a game day. Excuse me. And then we get in the helicopter. We fly up to downtown. He's asleep the whole time in the helicopter. And then, you know, I'm shooting all the time and, you know, just like you, fly on the wall, just kind of staying out of the way, letting him do his thing. And then we get in the limo from the office building where the helipad was to Staples Center, which is only a few blocks. And as we turn the corner to Staples Center, he sees everything going on. There's huge posters and banners, and every person has a Kobe jersey and the whole thing. And I go to take a picture, and I actually had a blimp because it was, you know, I just wanted to be so silent. And he just put his hand in and he goes, "Not now, man, I got to take this in." You know, it was so powerful for him, you know, but that's really the only time that with him that I ever had that experience. You know, Pete, unlike.
Can I say one thing?
Yeah.
That maybe you is related to that. I thought was very interesting is President Obama had this conversation with Derek Jeter after, you know, he had retired. And Derek was talking about how he had a photographer follow him pretty much his final year at all the, you know, ceremonies at different stadiums and stuff like that. And he regretted not having somebody do that throughout his career.
Really?
Which I thought was interesting.
That's very interesting. Yeah, I mean, look, when Kobe was a rookie or whatever, none of us could project 20 years ahead. But
no,
I knew something was special about this guy. I had the access, you know, through the Lakers that I had built, and it just sort of organically happened, you know. And then he started wanting me and trusting that I'd be there and all that. You know, Pete, you and I also have to at all times be locked in and doing our job, right? I mean, I tell young photographers all the time, if you're watching what's happening, you're not doing your job, okay? You have to have your eye in the viewfinder. You have to tune everything out. That's what you're there being paid to do. And you have been in some unbelievable situations, man. I mean, I don't know how you did it. I mean, in the documentary, I just shook my head. I mean, I think mostly of the Sandy Hook tragedy and going up there and being with the families and being with the president, and that poignant photo, that amazing photo that you took of him hugging one of the moms, and you know, other national tragedies. And I mean, I have a whole laundry list here, the disasters that you had to go to with the president, Iran-Contra with Reagan, even going back to that. I thought it was amazing, you know, that Nancy Reagan asked you personally to come and accompany the president's body back to Washington and document that, because she knew how important that was to the country and to her, of course, and her family. How do you do it, Pete? I mean, really, how did you do it? Did you just tune everything out? Is that how it worked?
I wouldn't say that I tuned everything out. I think that there certainly were times where I got caught up in the emotion. I think Sandy Hook, you mentioned, was the one that affected me more so in the moment than you know, perhaps any other situation I've been in, just because of the horrendous nature of that tragedy, you know, where there were 20 first grade kids that had been shot and killed. And how can we live in a country where that happens? And then, you know, 2 days later, he's meeting these parents, you know, and all of who had experienced, you know, what certainly was the most awful moment of their entire lives, each of them. And, you know, that one was hard for sure to, to, you know, do your job and do it in such a way that you don't feel voyeuristic. And knowing that if you can sense that there's a family that doesn't want me photographing in that moment, you've got to, you know, honor that. And again, that's just a sense. Now, so that for sure was the most difficult one for me.
You know, I love in the book how you preface that, or in the documentary, but also in your book, about, you know, the president going to Sasha's rehearsal, dance rehearsal, before going up to Connecticut. And as a parent, I mean, it just like got me right in the heart, man. What he must have been, the burden he must have been carrying, and the heaviness. And yet he's, you know, he's doing what these parents will never be able to do again, right? It's just, it's incredible. Now, I have some fear in my job, Pete. I mean, I have fear of guys like Shaquille O'Neal who've landed on me three times. You know, I thought that was the end of it. You know, there's some inherent danger in my job. But, you know, thinking about you, and especially thinking about when Reagan got shot, for example, you know, that was just an ordinary, he's coming out of the building into the limo situation, which you've done like 9,000 million times. Did it ever cross your mind? Like, you are, you know, you're like in the line of fire here, right? I mean, I know the Secret Service, like, they're getting paid to do that, but that's not your, you signed up for.
The one thing that I always kept in mind was I had full confidence in the Secret Service, you know, no question. But I also, in the back of my mind, realized that if the shit does go down, they're not going to protect me. You know, they got one person they got to protect.
Yeah. I mean, we're laughing about it, but it's true. Yes. Yeah.
And, you know, and certainly it was in the back of my mind, but I never thought, you know, anything would happen, to be honest with you. I know that, that it could, but seeing the precautions that the Secret Service took, I had pretty full confidence that I was never in danger.
I don't know, Pete. I would be thinking about it a lot. I mean, this came up last week when President Biden went to the Ukraine, right? The surprise visit and the 10-hour train ride and all that stuff into an active war zone.
That was crazy. I mean, you know, we did, I think, 5 unannounced secret trips into war zones, you know, once to Iraq, 4 times to Afghanistan. The difference in those situations were there were our military was on the ground where we were going.
Right.
Biden went to a country where our military was not on the ground, you know, so he's relying on the local military and his Secret Service on a 10-hour train ride, which is just incredible to me that was as risky a move for a U.S. president to make as any, I think.
Yeah. And then the fact that they told the Russians, like, they gave heads up, the president's coming to the, you know, your enemy. I mean, I guess, you know, diplomatically or whatever, they needed to do that, but that's sort of tipping your hand, don't you think? I don't
know. Well, it's tipping your hand, but I think if Putin had, knowing that information, had launched a missile attack, that would not have gone very well for Vladimir Putin.
For sure. Well, Pete, listen, this next section, we got to get into everything post White House, right? So, you know, you and I, again, flies on the wall, basically invisible, kind of part of the furniture, you know, apolitical, you know, although, you know, I had to hide my sort of Laker fandom, you know, on the side and do my job as much as I could. It'd be impartial. you described the dread that you had on January 20th, 2017, and the photos of the president leaving, finally waving goodbye and leaving, and the feeling in the pit of your stomach that it must have been like it was for the rest of us, by the way. Can you just even describe that, like that day, that moment, what you were feeling?
Yeah, I mean, I think it was, there were dual emotions playing out in my head. You know, one, you know, I gave that job everything I had for 8 years. You know, very few days off, no sick days. You know, I don't want people to feel sorry for me because I knew what I was getting into, but I was worn out. I was worn out physically. I was worn out emotionally. And so there was that emotion of, you know, oh, I'm so happy this is over.
Relief.
You know, I'm not relief that, you know, I don't have to carry that BlackBerry 24/7, that, you know, I will have weekends off, you know. So it was just a relief that the job had come to an end. And yet, on the other hand, I was sincerely worried about the direction of the country under, you know, his successor, that I didn't feel he was capable. I mean, I said somebody on the helicopter as we were flying away that, look, I said, I watched this guy, and I'm pointing to President Obama, and I call him this guy. I said, I watch this guy all the time in the Situation Room, you know, making decisions based on facts and intelligence and what he was being advised and arguing and, you know, but coming to a decision with a process. And I said to this person, I said, I don't think this next person is capable of that kind of, you know, thought process. So I was sincerely worried for the country, and honestly didn't know. I think I underestimated even how bad it could get.
Yeah. Know? Yeah. I hear you. I mean, you very eloquent on your concern for the country, but about the integrity of the office. You know, you had seen, you know, even going back to Reagan, but you had, whose politics you didn't necessarily agree with, but you could see what a real leader was, right? And
they had both Reagan and Obama, whether you agreed or disagreed with them, they were doing things that they thought was, you know, best for the country, and you know, as a whole. Whereas, you know, it clearly his successor was thinking about, well, what's best for me? Mm-hmm. That's it.
Yeah. So you hang up the BlackBerry, you go back to Madison, and it starts ruminating. I mean, like, what was the process? What was, like, I mean, I can see you sort of like starting to boil over as you're seeing what's going on and what's coming out of the White House. And feeling like, I don't put words in your mouth, but you must have been feeling like, I got to do something here. I mean, I have some kind of obligation. Is that what it was?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think that, I mean, one of the first photos I posted post White House on my now, you know, personal account was a picture of him, President Obama, sitting on the edge of the Resolute desk in front of those big, huge windows with, he had these kind of red curtains. This is after seeing a photo of the redecorated Oval Office in gold. And, you know, instead of one American flag and one presidential flag, there were like 10 flags. And, you know, it looked like a Saudi palace. And so I posted this photo of President Obama. And I just said something like, kind of like the old curtains better.
Right.
And, you know, obviously it was a play on the Trump Oval Office.
Sure.
And I didn't know that whether people would get what I was, you know, the double meaning of what I was saying. And they did, you know, they were like,
Well, people jumped
Souza
on that.
Souza is throwing shade, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And so as things progressed over those first few months, I would do these kind of humorous captions that didn't really refer to exactly what was going on. And you had to be keeping up with the news to understand it, you know.
Yeah.
And you know, I think that's how it just kind of organically started.
And what was the reaction from your former boss? I mean, was it kind of a wink, wink, you know, go ahead, Pete, you know, because he didn't say much. Trump took office, President Obama kind of, you know, let things play out until he really had to speak up. Right. Anyway, I'm just curious, you know, how
the funny thing about that year of 2017 was while I was doing these, you know, humorous, snarky posts on Instagram, I was also working on my book, which was a straight, you know, documentary book on his 8 years. And so I had like these two different things going on where, you know, for 90% of the day I was working on my book, and for like, you know, 10 minutes a day I was making a snarky post which was getting all the attention, you know. And I never purposely never talked to President Obama about the shade.
I don't even know if he knew
I'm sure some of his friends were telling him,
of course.
You know, I thought it was important for people to know that this is me talking. This is only me. This is not him. This is me talking.
Right.
So
interesting, man. And, you know, my world, you know, when I walk into an arena, the NBA owns everything I shoot, you know. And when I did the book with Kobe, we had to go back. The publisher had to go back and license my photos, pictures back. Right? Yeah. Right. So, you know, working for the government, I would assume they own everything. Right. So, how did that whole approval process work, especially for your personal Instagram?
Yeah, no, it's a little different in that there is actually no copyright. It's considered public domain.
Oh, okay.
So anything that had been made public during his administration, whether it had been on Facebook, on Flickr, if we had given photos to NBC for something or other, all those are public domain. And so that's what I used. Where I pulled from anything that had already been made public domain. I was free to use. Anybody was able to use those in any way they want. Now for my book, there were maybe, I don't know, between maybe 20 and 50, I don't even know the number, photos that had not yet been made public domain. And for those, he had to sign off on, you know, before I put them in my book.
Yeah.
And there's a whole process with the rest of the photographs on when they become, you know, quote unquote public domain.
Gotcha. You know, that's, and it's kind of similar with us. I mean, with all the NBA photographers, if whatever we shot was posted on Getty, then we're allowed to use it, right?
Yeah.
Doesn't have to have been published anywhere per se, but as long as it's on Getty. So, or we have to ask for approval, and you know.
Yeah.
Anyway, I was always curious about how that worked.
Yeah, but and then they're like you mentioned, you know, I worked during the Reagan administration, so enough time has gone by that literally every photo from the Reagan days is public domain now.
Right.
You know,
right.
So any photograph I could use, you could use, if you were doing a magazine article on, you know, the Lakers and Ronald Reagan or something, and you could go to the archive, and if any of those photos exist, you could use them.
I had no idea. That's interesting. Yeah. Pete, I want to talk about this book. You sent me this book. I absolutely love it. I have sent it to other people. This is an amazing book, I got to say, because there's not one picture of the subject of the guy you worked for in this book. Everything is behind the scenes. Everything is giving incredible light and respect to the people everyone around the president, everyone that made that work. I know as well as you, like if I'm not friends with the trainers and the physical therapists and, the security people, the bus drivers, you know, everybody from top to bottom, I can't do my job, right? They got to be like my best friends. They got to be on my Christmas card list. You know, I got to take care of them on the road, all that stuff, right? And it's genuine. I truly love these guys and women. What was the reaction to this book from some of those people? Because, you know, you probably maybe shared photos from time to time with them, but they finally saw it in print, and the respect that you and the honor that you gave them by putting them in this book. Did you get reaction from some of these folks?
Yeah, I think they were proud to be included in a book like that.
For sure.
And I have great reverence for not just the Obama appointees, but a lot of the pictures are of people that serve in the White House, no matter who the president is. These are the, you know, civil service employees, whether it's the butlers, the chefs, the Secret Service, the military pilots. Yeah. I mean, they're not, you know, assigned to one president. They work for multiple presidents. Yeah. And, you know, the White House could not function without them, for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. It's an amazing book. And what also is just incredible about you is that you never stop looking. I mean, you know, a lot of photographers are just looking in front of them and maybe a little bit left and right. You're looking behind you. You're looking on top, below. You got photos of guys like going underneath carpets, all kinds of stuff. I find that just, it's so inspiring that you just, you know, always looking, and you always, Pete, seem to have the perfect angle. I don't know how you do that. I'm thinking specifically of many photos of yours, but one specifically when Obama's waving goodbye for the final time, right, on that fateful day, you're inside the helicopter, and it, you know, most people would think, well, I got to get, you know, the Nixon shot outside the, you know, no, you're inside and you have him perfectly composed, you know, exposed, the whole thing, waving goodbye with the Capitol in the background. Incredible to me, Pete. I mean, are you consciously thinking that, or is it just always, I don't know, luck of the draw, like you happen to be in there and then he waved? I don't know. But I mean, how did that happen?
Yeah, I mean, I think I'd say that most 99% of the time, I'm not planning anything.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just reacting to whatever I see, whether it's in front of me or, as you say, behind me, and trying to take it all in, you know, and that's just 30 years of experience, right?
Being ready, preparation, right. Knowing your equipment.
You know, the last day is a different day. I got to make sure I'm on that helicopter, right? Mm-hmm. That's the first thing. So, you know, that's something that I talk to the staff about in advance. I have to be on the helicopter as he goes from the Capitol to Andrews, right? Air Force Base. Mm-hmm. And then you sort of can almost know what he's going to do. Mm-hmm. I mean, I couldn't say for sure that he was going to turn and wave, but that seemed like something he would do. So I'm getting myself in a position to be, you know, behind him and as he's in the doorway. That kind of thing, something that you sense is going to happen. Mm-hmm. You don't know 100% for sure, but that one is like, there's a little bit more thought in the planning than almost anything else I do. You know, also there's a picture in the book of him leaving the Oval Office for the last time.
Right.
Again, that's something I know he's going to do. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking about that ahead of time.
Right.
Whereas most times, as I said, I'm just like going with the flow.
Yeah, I can completely relate to that because, you know, Kobe, we knew it was going to be his last game. It's April 13th. In my mind, for months, I'm thinking the last picture has to be of him walking off the court, right? I had this guy as a rookie, and first picture is a Laker, last picture is a Laker. And I'm just strategizing. You know, we had three photographers at different angles shooting. But I have to get that shot, right? And to me, the shot is walking off the court, waving goodbye for the last time, which actually happened. but I almost got blocked by like a 400-pound security guy who just like wasn't moving until I like literally pushed him and yelled at him. And I, thank God I knew his name. But I can relate to that, man. And if I hadn't got that shot, you know, I don't even want to think about it, because that would, it would have been like an incomplete for my career, honestly. Pete, I know that, you know, there's so much more we can talk about. I have to, I'd be remiss if I don't thank you a million times over for sending me that amazing signed print of the Obamas with Bruce Springsteen, who, you know, I have the biggest boy crush on, that's hanging in our house. I just want to make sure you know that. The fact that you used High Hopes to lead into your documentary sealed the deal for me, buddy. Have you seen him on the tour yet? Or are you going to see him on this
tour? I haven't. I'm supposed to go see him on March 9th in Milwaukee.
Yeah. Oh, awesome. Great. Yeah. I saw him opening night. And then I was supposed to see him in Portland and Seattle, but I'm sure you know we got dumped with so much rain and snow. I couldn't even get out.
Yeah.
So I'm going to go. He's going to come back through, and hopefully, you know, I'll see him in LA. Pete, can you just give us the last thing I want to ask you is about getting married in the Rose Garden. I mean, what a moment, what a thing for the president to do for you. You kind of glossed it over a little bit in the documentary, I gotta say, because it what a gesture of humanity, of a friendship that he gave to you. This is off the cuff that he was giving you a hard time that you guys weren't married yet.
We had been together for 17 years. And he had gotten to know my wife a little bit. Mm-hmm. And he liked the joke that he liked her better than he liked me. You know, he just was hounding me all the time.
Yeah.
And he said, "Oh, well, we'll do it in the Rose Garden." And I was like, no. And he's like, "What? That's not good enough for you." And I think it was more like I didn't want him to feel pressure that if he were to marry us in the Rose Garden, that he'd have to do it for, you know, other couples.
Right.
And he's like, no, I'm not doing this for anybody else. This is just for you. So like, how do you say no to that?
Right? You don't. Right? Say thank you. Did he officiate it?
He did officiate.
That's just unbelievable, Pete.
Yeah.
What a moment. What a thing to have happened, man. That is just so incredible. So, Pete, you say pretty eloquently at the end of your documentary that you're pretty much done as a photojournalist. Is that true? Are you thinking of making a comeback?
Look, here's the thing is, like, I have, gone way beyond the bounds of what, you know, journalists would do in terms of letting my views be known politically. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the realization is, you know, Time Magazine or the New York Times is not going to hire me for an assignment, especially a political assignment. Right. Mm-hmm. So that's what I'm talking about. That mm-hmm. Am I still doing things photojournalistically? Absolutely. I mean, I've spent some time with Mandela Barnes, the guy that was running for Senate here in Wisconsin, photographing him journalistically, excuse me, for my Instagram, mm-hmm. you know, because I feel like I'm my own little publisher now.
mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, I do journalistic. I mean, I did a story for Howard University on the university president, who's also a cancer surgeon, that's in their current alumni magazine. So I spent like a week with him doing my thing, you know,
your thing,
journalistically.
Yeah, yeah.
But I mean, in terms of like covering politics for, you know, a publication, I don't think that is in my cards, if you will.
Yeah, I mean, you know, this is my 42nd season, and, you know, it's kind of running out of gas in terms of lighting my creative fire. I mean, you know, do have bills to pay, but I still love it. But I've tailed back a lot. Well, Pete, the offer is always out there, man. If you want to, you know, step into the arena, so to speak, at any time, we will make room for you. You know, if you feel like coming to the NBA Finals, you come and do your thing at the NBA Finals, you know, behind the scenes, whatever you want to do. It would be an honor for all of us to have you, you know, as part of our group. So that I'm putting that out there without checking with my boss first, but he'll go along with it.
And I would love to see you and I together, you know,
that would be fun
on the ground.
Let's do it sometime.
Well, let's seriously do it. And I will, you know, I will talk to the boss and make that happen. Not that boss, the other boss, but
right. You
know.
I got it.
Pete, listen, man, you are so gracious. You know, God knows how busy you are and how much, you know, time I took from your busy and very important day. But thank you so much for making the time to talk to me, to my audience. One of these days we got to go to Red Sox game together. I will do that because I make a pilgrimage every year to Fenway with my college friends for the last 40 whatever years. So hopefully we can do that. And
count me in.
Yeah, let's do it, man. And yeah. If you find yourself on the West Coast, you know, I missed your talk because I had a game that night when you were out here. So, you know, if you know you're coming out, give me a little heads up.
Okay.
Figure it out, okay?
But all right, Ian.
Thanks so much, man. So great to see you. And catch up again soon.
See you. Okay.
See you. Well, folks, I hope you all enjoyed this conversation with the legendary Pete Souza. So happy we were able to book time with him. He's always on the move doing speaking engagements and book signings. Please check out Pete's newest book, The West Wing and Beyond, What I Saw Inside the Presidency. It's an amazing behind-the-scenes look at everything and everyone that makes the White House and the presidency run efficiently. And you won't find one photo of the actual president in the book. Really an incredible and inspiring work. Thanks again to Pete for his time. Hope to see him sometime at a Red Sox game or maybe at a Springsteen show. Who knows? Many thanks to my terrific producer, Eugenia Chow, and our editors, Megan and Sean, as well as our social media manager, Michael. Remember, everyone, you can find us on the iHeart app and online, as well as Apple and Spotify and your favorite podcast platform. Keep following us on Instagram at Legends of Sport, our Twitter at Legends_of Sport. Our website is legendsofsport.net and our YouTube and TikTok channels, Legends of Sport. My photography can be found on Instagram and Twitter at ADB Photo Inc. Just a reminder, folks, about my upcoming masterclass workshop, Beyond the Lens. It's 12 weeks of wisdom, business, and life experience from me and some very special guests. Please sign up soon at beyondthelens.live. Thanks, everyone, for continuing to support the Legends of Sport podcast. Couldn't do it without you guys. Keep coming back. And remember to rate and review and tell all your friends. We'll be back next week with another great guest and episode. Until then, stay safe and stay well. Bye.